Welcome to the Performing Arts Series, brought to you by the John F. Kennedy Center for the Performing Arts and the Prince William Network. My name is Derek Gordon, Vice President for Education at the Kennedy Center. The musicians you just heard are part of the Kennedy Center's Arts from Ireland Festival, featuring outstanding artists in music, theater, dance, literature, and film from all areas of Ireland. They are some of the finest musicians in Ireland. Their music is called Irish traditional music, and it's been around for hundreds of years. It's an important part of Irish culture and connects people everywhere who have an Irish background to their cultural roots. And nowadays, it delights people all over the world, regardless of where they come from. Irish traditional music is essentially a melodic tradition, and there are literally thousands of tunes in the national repertoire. The musicians generally learn the music from friends, family, and neighbors, and often learn it by ear from other musicians. Historically, this music comes not from the upper or middle classes, but from the poorer parts of rural Ireland, where people have lived in poverty under British colonialism for centuries. For the most part, it was performed by gifted artists whose talents were greatly enjoyed but not financially supported because the communities were simply too poor to pay them for their art. But in the 18th and 19th centuries, in spite of the grinding poverty and deprivation, instruments such as the fiddle, the uilleann pipes, wooden flutes and tin whistles, and the bodhran made their way into the Irish countryside and were incorporated gradually into the native tradition. In the 20th century, the piano, guitar, and mandolin made their way into the musical culture. In the past, this music would be played for weddings, christenings, wakes, parties, and dances in homes and in small halls, or outdoors at crossroads conveniently located between towns and villages. The musicians would know a repertoire of dance music pieces that might include jigs, reels, hornpipes, polkas, mazurkas, flings, and waltzes. And they would play them with an exuberance that brightened the spirits of even the poorest, hardest working people in the toughest of times. Local singers would perform Irish songs too, but with a mood and setting that differed considerably from those in which instrumental music was played. Traditionally, songs were sung solo and a cappella to a small, attentive audience in private settings, such as an intimate house party. Today, you're going to meet five outstanding musicians, all visiting from Ireland, and you'll hear them perform and talk about their music. Mick Moloney, a well-known Irish musician and musicologist now living in Philadelphia, will interview them. I hope you will enjoy this look at Irish traditional music and that you'll be able to hear echoes of our own American popular music in these performances.
Ronan, what's that instrument there?
These are the Irish uilleann pipes. They're the Irish version of the bagpipes that exist all over the world. Uilleann is the Irish word for elbow, and you're using your elbows when you're playing. You pump with your right elbow put into the bellows. So with the Scottish pipes, you blow with your mouth. With these, you pump with the bellows. The air goes into the bag, which is like a football. And that goes under your left arm. And the melody is played on the chanter. All pipes all around the world have a chanter. The big difference with this one and all the other ones is that this has two octaves because it's a dry reed. The reed is inside here. I'll just take it out carefully and show you. It's a double reed, the same as what you'd have on an oboe. The lips here are shaved very thin and they vibrate to give the sound. Here's where I break the reed. And these have a second octave. You can overblow and you get a full two octaves, which makes them far more advanced than most other pipes. So that's the melody. And when you are beginning to play the pipes, you would maybe start with the bellows, the bag, and the chanter. That's all you need. Then later on, you would progress to the drones and regulators. There are three drones, bass, baritone, and tenor. And they're in three octaves of the bottom note on the chanter, which in this case is D. So you've got D, an octave below, and two octaves below. These are turned on and off with a switch. That's what they sound like when they're off. Very quiet. And this is what they're like when they're on. So there's the tenor, baritone, and they're tuned by moving up and down on a slide. And the bass. And they lie underneath the music all the time as you're playing. And then what really makes the Irish pipes unique are the regulators, again, tenor, baritone, and bass. They're stopped at the ends. They have keys on them with springs. So when you're not playing them, again, like the drums in the off position, they make no sound. When you press them, you get chords. And the way they're played is, as you're playing on the chanter, the bottom of your hand, this part here, plays the chords. So it's a very, very difficult operation to work. Excuse me. So when everything is going, you have melody and six harmony, seven reeds in total. Like that.
Are they hard to keep in tune?
Unbelievably. With seven reeds, you have seven potential areas of difficulty. If you imagine an oboe player always changing the reed and fixing things, with this you have seven reeds. If somebody opens the door, a gust of wind comes in, they'll all go out of tune. So it is very difficult to keep in tune. That's one of the hardest parts.
Right. Now, there's a kind of a stereotype in Irish music that pipers are eccentric people. Do you think there's any truth to that?
Oh, definitely.
I'm incredibly normal.
Yeah? Cheerful?
No. Pipers are always very angry.
Yeah.
And I'm very angry.
Yeah.
But to you, I'll be nice.
Yeah.
All pipers aren't eccentric, but the pipes do draw eccentric people to them. So you do find people who maybe would be rock climbers and had climbed Mount Everest. What else can I do? Pipes. I'll play a piece called Port Nabuki, which is Irish, in the Irish language, which means the music of the fairies and the spirits. It comes from the Blasket Islands off the southwest coast of Ireland. There are various stories about where the tune came from. Another story, which I think is the one that's probably the correct one, is that they were listening to whale song, and the very light canvas-bottomed boat was acting like a loudspeaker, and the sound was coming up from under the water, and they were able to hear it through the hull of the boat. And somebody did give me a tape of whale song, and the killer whales were making a lot of noises which were very close to this air, especially to the first three notes. So I'll just check my tuning and I'll play it for you.
Let me ask you a very basic question, Kevin. What's the difference between a violin and a fiddle?
The answer to that is, Mick, it depends on what part of town you come from. If you're from the north side of Dublin, you're a fiddle player. And if you're from the south side, you're a violinist.
Well, that's a good question.
But, I suppose, there's absolutely no difference.
Yeah.
No.
Is there a difference between how Irish music is written and how you would play it?
Huge difference. An absolute huge difference. I've been asked this question a few times, so do you want me to give you a little demonstration? Okay. Just bear with me for a second. Pretty standard tune in Irish music would be Miss McLeod's Reel. It would be one of the first reels that most musicians, pipers, flute players, etc. would learn. If you were to read it, it would probably be written something like... First part, the way I play it.
What would you call what you're doing there?
Okay, the basic ornamentation that fiddle players would use would be, primarily would be a roll, would be set on a long note. It's the way it'd be written, but what you might do would be, you're doing a double roll there. And then you go on, two triplets with the right hand, rather than, you do, again, rolls, now, while the improvisation mightn't be, we'd say from a jazz perspective, incredibly complicated, it's still there, it's done within kind of the technique that you learn as a player.
Could you tell us the difference between the way the fiddle is played, say, in Donegal and in County Sligo and, say, County Clare and County Kerry, all down the west coast of Ireland?
Well, for a start, starting with up in the northwest, where my father happened to come from, the bone is single bone. The bone is constantly moving. It's a vigorous bow style. Most of the ornamentation is done with the bow. And if I can just take an example of a jig. If I was to play a jig... in the Donegal style, I'm overemphasizing the chorus now, but I'll just. It will be played something like. Now, if you're to play a jig, we say. Down around East Galway. The style is a lot more, it's not as aggressive is probably the wrong word, but it's not as vigorous. It's still, to an extent, there's an emphasis on single bone, but there's also more of an emphasis on the augmentation on the left hand. It would be something like this. That's the way that they would approach a jig. As you would move further south, we say around the Sliabh Lucra area, the emphasis is probably, it's equally on the left hand and on the right hand. The bone isn't single, it's more slurred, and it would be probably something like... Okay, I'll continue with a piece of music. It's a bit like the Blessed Trinity. There's three pieces in the one. The first one is a slow air. It's called Lament for Glencoe. The second one is called Stirling Castle. And the third tune is called Miss Ramsay's. Thank you.
Thank you.
Do you prefer your own songs, or?
They come from a different place, you know.
Yeah.
When you learn a song by somebody else, well, like I didn't start writing till I was about 28 or 29. Mm-hmm. But when you sing somebody else's song, it's coming from the outside, you know. So you learn it. It's just a different technique, really, of learning, you know. It's a second-hand thing. When it comes from inside, you know exactly what every single syllable means. So I suppose that you might be able to put more resonance into it or something, you know.
Now, what do you write your songs about? What particular themes come up in your songs?
I write about things, not always about myself, you know. But even if you write about something else or somebody else, you have to imagine yourself being that person. So I suppose you have to dig deep. If you're going to write sincere songs, you have to dig deep mm-hmm. and put yourself in someone else's shoes, mm-hmm. you know.
Do you listen to American songwriters?
I do a lot, yeah.
Yeah. The funny thing is, a lot of Americans who wouldn't know that much about Ireland, they're really surprised to find out when they go to Ireland that younger people in Ireland are listening to the same kind of music they're listening to over here and know even many times a lot more about American music than they do themselves. Do you have any idea why there are so many rock bands that have come out of Ireland now that have achieved international recognition? I'm thinking of bands, say, like U2 and the Cranberries, and even maybe lesser-known bands like the Waterboys, Hot House Flowers, and, say, the Saw Doctors.
Well, I think the thing about it, Irish people love words, you know, mm-hmm. and they love talking, and it's probably their favourite thing to do in the whole world. Mm-hmm. They love to read as well. I think Irish people love to read a lot. And there are people, they just use words in a very picturesque way. And I was thinking about this recently now, why Irish rock is so successful is that the songs are very weighty, you know. I mean, they're in a rock idiom, but they actually say something, you know, as opposed to like a formula type thing, you know. And I don't know, I suppose we have a tradition of music that goes back, you know, eons. So, I mean, it's just natural that in the modern day that would carry on, that the music tradition, it's a tradition of a different sort, I think, you know.
Yeah.
People have always written songs in Ireland, you know. I mean, there are songs that are hundreds and hundreds of years old, you know. So I think, I don't know. But sometimes I think that maybe there's not as much... it's not as mysterious in Ireland to write. People don't find it to be a big deal as much as other places. Maybe, I don't know, but maybe. Right, I'm going to carry on now with an unaccompanied song. And this is a song called The May Morning Dew. And it tells a very, very sad story of a man who goes away for a number of years and comes back to find everybody he knew and loved dead and gone. How pleasant in winter to sit by the hob, listening to the barks and the howls of a dog. It's summer to wander the wide valleys through and to pluck the wild flowers in the May morning dew. Summer is coming, oh, summer is here. With the leaves on the trees and the skies blue and clear, and the birds, they are singing their fond notes so true. And the flowers, they are springing in the May morning dew. The house I was reared in is but a stone on a stone. And all round the garden, the weeds, they have grown. Like the red roses withered in the May morning dew. God be with the old folks who are now dead and gone. And likewise, my brothers, young Dennis and John, as they trip through the heather, the wild hare to pursue, with their joys they are mingled in the May morning dew.
Well, we move along to the flute, and I suppose the first thing that most people would ask you in America is, what is that flute? Because people are more familiar with the silver flute. Mm-hmm. And obviously that's not a silver flute.
No, no, because it's black. Yeah.
It's not a black silver flute then?
No, it's not a black silver flute either, no. That'd be worth a few bob. It's actually an Irish traditional wooden black side flute of an ethnic and Hibernian nature.
That is an excellent thing. Now, is the wooden flute more suitable for Irish music than the silver flute?
Yeah, it's got a lot richer kind of and a wider tone.
Yeah.
It's kind of, I suppose, you know, it's got a woody sound, obviously, as well. The silver flute is a very pure and precise pitch about it and sound, whereas this is a lot more flexible in terms of wide notes, rushy sounds, that type of stuff.
Yeah.
And also the fact that it doesn't have keys, you know, so you're getting a much faster response. If you played a reel on a silver flute, you'd be getting clickety, 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 clickety. You'd be like a bones player and a flute player at the same time. Sorry, Tommy.
You'd be
out of a job.
You'd be out of a job, I would. Yeah.
But it's just cumbersome, you know?
Yeah. Kevin was talking about putting different kinds of ornamentation into the playing to make it sound Irish. Do you have the same challenge with the flute?
Yeah, a lot of the ornamentation that's done in the fiddle, which would say rolls, would be done in the flute as well, you know?
The very same way?
Same notes, anyway. Very same notes. So you're doing G roll, you're doing G.
G, A, G, F, G.
Yeah, well, I do B. When I roll in the flute, I generally do the note, two notes above the note and one note below the note, where that's possible. Obviously, on, let's say something like B, you can't. Yeah. But on, I generally go two up and one down. You go one up, one down.
G, so I go, A, G, F, G.
So for A, I go C. Mm-hmm. A, C, A, G, A. How would you do?
For an A
roll. C.
No. G, A, B, A, G, A.
Yeah, I go C. I go M. But that's only the way I do it. Other fellas do it different, you know? I'm going to play two reels. The first one is called Lord Gordon's Reel. And the second one is Kiss the Maid Behind the Bar, if you could find the bar in this place. We'll be right back.
Tommy, Mick. You play a whole variety of percussion instruments there.
Yep.
And I see a bodhran.
Mm-hmm. You do? There's a bodhran.
And what else do you play there?
Well, in the traditional Irish sense, I would play the bodhran. I'd play the spoons.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to... And the sunglasses, obviously. And I play the bones, which also are obviously an American tradition.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if they came from Ireland and hit America, but I doubt it because idiophones are, you know, the term would be mm-hmm. would be idiophone for two things striking together. but the American tradition is two-handed.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a set in each hand and they do cross rhythms off each other.
Mm-hmm.
There is an actual bone society on the web. Rhythmbones.com, if anyone wants to check it out. In traditional...
It's not rhythmbones.court, is it?
No. Definitely not. Thank you. In traditional Irish, bones playing normally use two bones. These would be the rib bones of a goat. They usually use cow bones. I don't particularly like them because they're heavier and they're shorter and they bend more. So they're not as easy, for me, they're not as easy to play. These are professionally made. You pay about $50 now for a set of them. They're very difficult to play. I mean, I can't, it's not an easy percussion instrument to play. It's probably one of the most difficult in the Irish tradition to play because it takes a lot of work just to get that basic stroke. That's actually harder to do that than it is to do. Just doing that. It's like fly fishing. That's the motion you have, you know. I'll put them down. The other one would be the spoons, which obviously are pretty common. But you don't see, I've never seen spoons. Let me think. Have I ever seen spoons being played in any other tradition? Not to my knowledge, but obviously I haven't seen everybody play, but I've never seen spoons being played
uh-huh.
outside of the Irish tradition. And if you're going to try playing the spoons, stainless steel, they're soup spoons in America, aren't they? These are dessert spoons in Ireland, but they're soup spoons here. Do you hold them in your hand with your thumb bent? And
a thumb?
Where I come from, they say thumb. And
good man, thummy.
Thank you, Conal.
Thummy.
Hand around, keep your left hand steady. Bob's your uncle.
Oh.
The other stuff gets kind of complicated then. But in terms of bodhran, I would play the basic, well, it's not a basic drum because they've gone a lot more high-tech than they were 20 years ago. They're tunable, so you can actually tune them to a pitch. This would be goat skin. And this would be technically a frame drum. I mean, every culture has a frame drum. But what makes this drum uniquely Irish is actually the way that it's played. It is the only percussion instrument in the world that is played with a bent wrist. Every other percussion instrument is either played directly like this or with straight sticks. It's the only one where you actually bend your wrist. It is the only one that you strike obliquely. Every other percussion instrument you hit it directly on. This one you glance off the skin. It is the only one that is played with a double-headed stick, and you actually play both sides of the stick. That's what makes it uniquely Irish. So when you get a triplet, you're playing. I'll do it more traditional way because my style is slightly different. Is an actual triplet. So using both ends of the stick.
Up, come.
We hope you've enjoyed today's performances by these outstanding artists. I think you'll agree that they all really enjoyed playing together. It's this sense of communal enjoyment and the greatness of the art and the artistry that makes Irish music so irresistible to everyone who comes across it. Although this music originated in Ireland, today this tradition is now every bit as much American as it is Irish. This did not happen overnight, of course. For centuries, musicians from counties and villages all came to America, creating a rich cross-fertilization of Irish and American folk music styles. Irish music has also been influential in the development of popular American forms of music, such as old-time mountain music, country and western, and bluegrass. Collaborations between Irish and American artists have never been stronger, and young Americans everywhere are taking up the old music and excelling at it as never before. Today, you can hear Irish music all over America, in all sorts of places. You can hear it on public radio and television, and you can enjoy it in live at festivals, concerts, clubs, and pubs from east to west. Irish music has never been more popular at home or abroad than it is today. A population that once resided on a small island, closely bound by a cultural heritage and a way of life, has now spread to every corner of the globe. Today, Irish music remains a powerful expression of a culture and a people, but one that now delights the entire world. I'd like to thank you for joining us today. If you'd like to ask a question, you can contact us by using email, and the address is on the screen. We'd love to hear from you. We'd also like to invite you to visit the Kennedy Center and Prince William Network websites at the addresses on the screen. There you'll find information on upcoming programs as well as other resources on integrating the arts into the curriculum. We'd like to hear what you thought about this Kennedy Center Performing Arts program. So we have provided an electronic form for comments and suggestions. It's on the Prince William Network website. Fill it out so we can select topics and resources you want to enhance your classroom experience. I'd also like to remind you that our next performance will be on Wednesday, April 4th at 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, when Dr. Billy Taylor will talk about his experiences on New York's 52nd Street and perform many of the songs that made that era so famous in jazz history. We thank you for watching.
We'll play you a blast of reels, the old bush, and a very true statement, my love is in America, and Trim the Velvet. Thank you.
Thanks very much to the Kennedys for having us. Bye bye.
Bye bye.